name is Don Solomon, and I pastor Little Grove Baptist Church here in Birmingham, and been in gospel singing now around 70 years.
Sir.
I'm on a voice rest at the time, maybe you can understand. M.B. Wooding Jr., Greater St. John Missionary Baptist Church, Birmingham. Member of the Pillars.
Member of the Macedonia Baptist Church, service channel of our board there, and also sang with the Delta Ass Quartet. I'm the older member there. Been singing for 70 years. And trying to press on as many more as I can get in.
My name is Henry Baden. I'm a member of First Baptist Mountain Park Baptist Church. Reverend William M. Smith, my pastor. I'm also a member of the Pillars. I've been singing for 69 years. God allow me and give me the strength. I hope I can sing 69 more.
Go ahead and do it. Okay. One of the elements we've seen throughout the presentations is the connection of some of the singers and their family members, and in reading your biographies, I believe I came across some accounts of where your lives and the communities you lived in were tied to the rise of the steel and iron industry here in the mills and mines. And I was wondering if some of you who worked in the industry or had family connected to the industry could talk a little bit about that era in Jefferson County and the role of music either in the workplace or in the communities tied to the rise of iron and steel in Bessemer. In Birmingham, too.
Well, if I might say a word or two about that, we've been saying in the Birmingham and Jefferson County area, originally I'm from Selma, Alabama, where we sang there for years, and came to Birmingham and joined the End of Jubilee Singers and just sang with them for a while, and from them, the Four Eagles, I sang with them. But for the work concern, what to work for, just let me say this. Work was getting very slack when I got a job at U.S. Steel, and they had laid off 5,000 men. And one night I was sleeping, and something woke me, and I said, go out to the plant in the morning, the man gonna hire you. And I looked everywhere in the room, nobody was there, I could see. And I was afraid, I could not get comfortable no kind of way. So I told the old gentleman, and he said, that might be the Lord talking to you. Sure enough, I went out there, I had one dime, and lost it. So I couldn't ride out there. So sitting there looking, I found the dime, and I got out there, I met all these men who was coming from out there. He said, you better run, and maybe call your name all day. Well, they didn't even know me, but I ran out there, and the man said, why are you running like this? I said, they told me you've been calling my name all day. So the man said, well, we're not hiring no young men, we're hiring seasoned men, but we're hiring nobody now. But one of them said, wait till the lunch period is over, and I want to pull your resume up and find out if we can hire you. So I did. To make a long story short, I got hired that day when I saw about 400 men walk away, wasn't hired. So I'm a firm believer the Lord has something for you. He will bless you if you will do his will. As far as the working concern, the steel mills, I never worked in the mine, but I have a lot of friends who have worked in the mine, has blessed Jefferson County in so many ways. So many of us raised our families working there, and we're grateful. I worked there 43 years, and the Lord let me walk away from the plant, and I'm grateful for the services that was rendered. And I could go on and on, but I know time won't permit us to. But it has been a blessing to me, and the Lord allowed me to go out there and work and walk away as I went in, and I'm thankful for it.
And Aguster,
You were mighty handsome in that video, by the way. I just want to say that.
Very kind.
Maybe you could say something, and then I know Henry worked in the steel for many years, and of course, MB worked in the mines. But before we move on to Henry, can you say something about the emergence of the Delta Airs and your singing? What if any, do you see a connection between your time with U.S. Steel and the formation of that group and the sound that we're now calling the Bessemer Sound?
Well, I do believe that Jefferson County has a special sound. We call it the Quartet Sound, that we cherished in the early days, and we cherish today, because as we travel around and meet with Quartet Jefferson County area, many of them originally from here, and they're still singing. If you get down and talk to them one-on-one, many of them will lead you right back to much of their experience and learning have arrived from this area. And I promise you, if you will go and do your best from this area as a singer, whoever has to sing along with you or come behind you will have to do a good job in order to be recognized there. So as an old timer, I'm just proud of the sound and the fellowship that we have here in Jefferson County, in Birmingham. Me and Reverend Saul there have been singing periodically together since the early 40s. So, and I know there are others here who have been here longer than I has, but we're grateful for it. I think it's been a blessing to us. It still is a blessing. And that's allowed me to say to all of us here today, all of you all who had a hand in, my good friend is a Doug back there, who had a hand in putting this together and making it to be a reality, I think that it is good. Reverend Stewart, the quartet man, with longtime friends and other friends back there, we just feel like that this is a real blessing to us. And if you allow me to say thank you all for your input and your foresight and making this to be a reality, we thank you.
Henry Burton, tell us a little.
Well, I've worked in the steel mill, U.S. pipe and foundry, for 40 years and 6 months. And out of those 40 years and 6 months, I was never out of a job. It was a rough place. I even contact asbestos from the job that I was. I have asbestos right now. I'm not worried about that because I had to work. But I thank the Lord for me being as healthy as I am. But the gospel singing down through the years, I actually believe when it comes down to acapella singing that Alabama has put out more acapella singers than any state in the Union. I've heard a lot of groups. I've been in contact with a lot of groups. I started out with the Mattock Gospel Singers. William Blevins was the first black radio announcer. He gave me the opportunity to sing a solo on his show. I was 11 years old. And from there on up, I started to sing with quartet. And I met a lot of quartets, but most of them I met was singing a cappella. And then I ran into Brother Woody. I think I was 16 years old when I started singing with Brother Woody. We sung together for about 30 or 40 years when that young man there was about 6 years old, his grandson. And I had an opportunity one time Carlo Turner was my cousin, the lead for the Pilgrim Travelers. And I had an opportunity to go on the road with the Pilgrim Travelers when my cousin came to do a show here at the City Auditorium, and he heard me sing with the group out a little, and he came over to my mother's house, who was his aunt, and asked her, could I go and travel with them? And she told me, said, you know, Junior, you don't need to go, you're too young. You stay here. I found out later why, you know, and I'm appreciative to obeying her. I was mad at the first time because I was dealing with how they sound and everything, but that wasn't her message. And I'm glad I stayed here because I was inspired with the groups that, all those groups that he showed on the film there. I met all of them practically and been involved with them. And I'm glad because they inspired me to go on, you know, in the name of the Lord. And I just don't believe there are no other state in the Union that have the impact of a cappella singing to carry it on. We got a lot of groups here that y'all know. I mean, we got a lot of a cappella groups here. Brother Stewart probably know more of them than I do because he's involved with them and everything. And I just, all these years, I'm just so happy and proud that I've been able to, the gift of God give me to share it with you, with the entire world, with the entire population. Let me say this here. I got to say this. One morning we came off Fox 6. And Brother Freeman told us that, they said, right at how many million people heard y'all this morning?
Thousands, I guess.
Said so many million people. No, that was George said, so many people heard y'all this morning. And that made me feel good to be able to do this type of a singing and let it stretch out. Because surely we losing it. We're not losing it in Alabama, but in the widespread. A cappella singer was going down. And we are able here now, Brother Solomon got us together, and we're able here now to kind of, and Brother Moss, we're trying to bring it back up. And this, I think this is what God wants us to do. Because a cappella is not so much how pretty it is, it's the words that give you the message. The words of the song that gives you the message. And there's a message in every song that we sing. And I'm glad to be able to deliver that message with my talent. Thank you.
And talk a little bit about maybe the minds as you remember them, and did they help formulate your history in this music?
If y'all can understand me,
we can understand.
In short, I worked in the old mine, 1943. We furnished material for the steel people. They waited until we sent material out there. In the old mine, it is screwed. We called it TCI, Tennessee Coal Line and Railroad Company. That raw old, we would ship it out there to Fairfield. Choo-choo train would haul it out there to them. At that time, it was about 8 or 10 groups that I can remember singing. Before I get that, Birmingham, Jefferson County, Alabama, are the incubator for gospel singing. Most groups that went off and made good, their launching pad was from Birmingham, Jefferson County, Alabama. the Macmillans, my dad was the manager of them. They was organized in 23. And I left them in 42. 47, I left them. And in the Jubilee, the Sterling Jubilee, the Crane Jubilee, Bessler Big Four, all those groups was nice. Sweet Rose, White Rose, they all was here. And at that time, was really popular. I see some CDs out there said the Sacred Heart, that was going big back there at that time. We called them Shape Notes at that time. They was really good, and we would have crowd. I know the time of Freeman, we would go to a church. They didn't charge for 10 cents, and you couldn't get in there for 10 cents. Good singing. And in short, my dad and them would walk 4 or 5 miles to the church. They would walk from Powder to Fairfield with the shoes under the arm. They walked from there to Shady Grove, that's over there at Oxmoor. And people would be there waiting on them. And I sung with several groups, I won't go in that name, but it's been a historical and a fascinating Christian journey for me. They started working on my voice in January, and I'm satisfied. I tell them all, if I never sing again, I'm happy.
All right.
I started when I was 7. But the song said, be patient with me. God is not true, I'm gonna sing again. Thank God.
Thank you. Within the group, because we have younger members now. But Don says she wasn't in iron and coal. Tell us a little bit about your history in the 40s and how you came up. And talk a little bit about the Blue Goose and what was going on in Manhattan Cleaners.
Thank you, Mr. Bob. I was just reflecting on, as the guys were talking, on the fact that it's just really good to be alive. Mm-hmm. I'm approaching 80, and Norman is already 86, and Burton is 80, approaching 80, and it's just good to be here. When I look at the fact that my first recollection of Norman Wooding was him coming to WBCO, old radio station on Bessemer Superhighway, if I remember correctly, yeah. And that the same man, William Blevin, that was mentioned before, he was the first black man on radio with a program where he could talk on the microphone. And,
that's right.
And he was our hero. He was the first black man to do that. Mm-hmm. And he was a gospel singer and had a gospel group. As a matter of fact, Long Beach Ministry song with the group, didn't it? With William Blevin's group. But anyway, you were there with him back at that time. But anyway, he had a gospel singing group. And I remember Norman singing with the other original group that I heard him with back in the 40s. I believe it was the Kelly Choral, if I remember. Was that right? Kelly Choral. And then I sit here in the presence of a lady within his own self, Roscoe Robbins. And I remember when the Blind Boys of Mississippi presented him to America, and he has made a great record, and it has been a pleasure listening to you all of these years. Yes. Happy to be in your presence. And then my entree into gospel quartet singing like the other guys was a natural, because that's what we did. As young men coming up in the 40s, that's what we did. I started in a quartet in the 5th grade at Washington Elementary School. We called ourselves the Titusville Spiritual Fire. And that was back way back in the 40s. Anyway, I was 13, and then Robert, you all met Robert. Robert is the lead singer. we stayed together, we were together now. But anyway, and we went on to become the Heavenly Four. At age 13, we were the Titusville Spiritual Five, and at age 15, we were the Heavenly Four. And there were four same guys, just became the Heavenly Four. And in between those 3 years of becoming the Heavenly Four, we started with a group called the PCW Aggregation, Roberto Rolo. Roberto Rolo came on the radio every Saturday night. And so we were just singing our way through the day. Quartets everywhere, all over town. Every Sunday evening somewhere. I mean, it was just beautiful. Quartets everywhere. So the Heavenly Four did a good job. As a matter of fact, the Heavenly Four stayed together with us young folk until 49. I went to the Air Force in 49, and we broke up in 49, but the Heavenly Four went on to sing after I left. But Robert and I, who were the original members of the Heavenly Four, I went to the Air Force on Tuesday, and Robert went to the Marines on Wednesday. We both went different ways, and the Korean War started in June, and it took us 3 years to see each other again. But anyway, we both lived through the war and got back. But and we came back singing right around here in Birmingham. Now, Roscoe and my dear friend George Stewart, another legendary, the founder of the Gospel Quartet Convention, give George a great big hand. George Stewart, the founder of the Gospel Quartet here. He's a Birmingham man, but it's the International Quartet Convention that meets here in Birmingham every January. Is that right?
Every January.
Yeah, you need to get the word out on that, George. That's a wonderful thing. I really enjoy it. And gospel singing did it all.
Yes.
Because we were here when you were born. And we were singing, and you heard it, latched on to it, and now you formed an International Quartet Convention. And all of us are members, amen? That's great, George. But anyway, reflecting a little bit on my life, George, you and Roscoe wouldn't know that you guys knew me as a big time businessman, Dr. Gasol's number one man, who ran the insurance company and all the other things that he had. But in my heart was laboring an old gospel singer from way back. But you all didn't know that. I wasn't practicing gospel singing then, I was just visiting. I wasn't in no quartet at that time. But I was housing all the quartets. All of the quartets in town under my supervision. And I kept telling all of them, you guys better stay in the group because one of y'all mess up, I'm gonna get in there and take you apart. And all these years, they were all wanting to know, when is Don Solomon going to sing? Is he ever sung in the weather? I was bossing everybody.
Yes, sir.
But eventually, of course, in the latter part of my career in the last 4 or 5, when I retired and everything, I had an idea of a sound that I wanted to hear, that I had learned coming up through the years. And I asked the Lord if I could hear and manufacture that sound one more time before I go home. And the Lord blessed me and sent me over to JLD where I was on the broadcast anyway. And I said to Norman, I got a sound I want to hear before I go home there. But I got a song I want to hear. And those guys agreed. And Bob, can you imagine? Bob from New York stands up. I'll help you. I said, what? Bob.
Yeah.
I discovered that he could sing bass. African bass,
mm-hmm.
Colored bass.
Yeah.
He could sing it.
Yeah.
And so these guys let me hum my thought to them, and we became the Pillars. And we've been pillaring ever since. And now we're training up all the young crew here, hope that they'll grab hold, they'll find young men, hoping to pass it on to them.
Yeah.
Because it is a great sign.
Yeah.
And we want that thing of 4-5-part harmony, everybody on the track, it's hard to beat. And you can't do it if you don't know how to do it. Let nobody fool you. You know, anybody can say, I don't believe that. That ain't true. You have to know this stuff. It's in your heart, in your system.
Yeah.
we've been doing it ever since. I've been very fortunate to be among these gentlemen and others. And now I'm at the sunset of my life and enjoying every day still with that sound. But the more, I became the first black quartet on WVOK was my group, the Heavenly Four, followed by the Four Eagles. So I have some great history there. All of the, you know, the WVOK was 50,000 watts back in that time. It used to be a big, big thing. We were 50,000 watts. It was all over the country. They had Joe Rubo. Y'all remember Joe Rubo? It was all over the country. All up in Talladega and all up in them places. And they heard the Heavenly Four every Sunday morning at 7 o'clock. And the letters and the phone calls started coming. And so we traveled all over Alabama where they could hear WVOK. They heard us. And we became very, very popular around the state of Alabama. So it's been a great, great career. And I was just looking at some of the names that the picture that was on this picture that you showed here. All of those men, we met them in our lifetime. All of them. The last one that I talked to personally was Claude Tina. George, the quartet convention, brought him to Birmingham. We at the Heavenly Four had traveled with the Swan Silvertone. And when George, it took me over to Jeter, he was in the wheelchair and of course and everything. I think said he was 90 years old or whatever, but anyway. When George had told Jeter, I got a friend of yours I want to see, Don Solomon. Do you know what Jeter said to Don Solomon? You still here? But that's an experience. That's God's saying did that for us. It was really amazing, and that's what I've been doing, and that's what we do. And I'm very delighted to be here with these giants of gospel, and you who come to let us talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Reverend. And speaking of Bob being from New York, I know you're the one person here who moved from another part of the country, so. I'm not going to make you go sit down at the end of the table, but if you could share your experiences on growing up singing in New York and what that was like and how that led to your passion and participation in gospel quartet tradition here in Jefferson County.
Okay. I'll take a moment on that. I started singing when I was about 16, actually about 15, in New York City. And New York City had groups on every street corner. New York City was the capital of doo-wop. It was not known as doo-wop back then. It got manufactured about, I don't know, 10, 15 years later as a term. All it was a lyric, actually, in certain records. And I was trained in classical piano. And so I could see where the chord was in my head. I could see where every member was supposed to move. And so it didn't take much to take some of the pop songs that my older brother used to play on the piano, like Strangers in Paradise and songs like that, and convert them into doo-wop songs, which I did, and met with friends at the Y, where we all hung out when we had a chance to kind of play bumper pool and dance to the jukebox and so forth. This is about 58, 59, 60 in that area. And from there, it just continued. I mean, I didn't stop singing with a group. Maybe for a couple of years, I sang with groups in New York City, and we won Amateur Night at the Apollo, and we met all kinds of incredible performers, recorded with groups, and most of it was all a cappella, with the very exception of perhaps bringing a stand-up bass and a piano into a rehearsal. But we loved a cappella. And I'm not going to toss around the names of the groups, but some people may know the Sparrows Quartet. I moved to Chicago and sang with a group called Yesterday's Rhythm. We did shows with the Spaniels. You may know who they are. They sang Good Night, Sweetheart, Good Night, and a lot of other great records. The Eldorados, the Drifters, the Shirelles, lots and lots of groups we were on stage with. In 1963, we were at a place called Lenox Lanes in the middle of Harlem, and I sang for the first time His Eye is on the Sparrow, and I sang the bass. I was 19. And we all had the Harmonizing Fours album, everybody in the group. We loved the Harmonizing Four. We were singing pop stuff. We were singing Love Will Come Back to Me, and any way we could jazz up harmony, we were into progressive harmony. But when we heard the Harmonizing Four sing His Eyes on a Sparrow, and the rest of what's in that album, it just swept us away. It swept me away. I've been singing that song for a long time. When I moved to Chicago, one of the things I did at a very large meeting of people who were struggling with the welfare system in Chicago, I was a community organizer back then, and they didn't know who this guy was either, this white guy from New York, you know, and who the heck was he, and, you know, why should we listen to him? So I sang His Eyes on the Sparrow. I sang Jimmy Jones' part, and I sang the tenor part, too. Oh, why should I feel discouraged? I sang the whole thing. And that endeared me to a lot of people. And that movement went on to elect Harold Washington, the first black mayor of Chicago. So the music is incredibly important and emotional and connective in so many ways to people. That's my upbringing, singing with these groups. And Don was really the first person at JLD that actually got all charged up about, you know, the quartet singing. And so I shared with him some of the 78s that I had and stuff. And we, and, you know, from there it was history. And I can't tell you what it's meant to me to be. In some ways, I feel these are my dear brothers and friends, but I also feel allowed and privileged in many ways to be able to travel with these gentlemen and to sing in. I've been in more churches than most people you know, I think. And I've enjoyed every minute of it because it's been decent, if I can put a word to it. The people I've met have been decent. And that's very refreshing. Yeah. So, thank you.
Yeah, I was in Korea, South Korea, a place called Daegu. I was there from 52 to 54. And that was the only thing that I did in the service. I never did have to go to the front line. I never did. I mean, God just blessed me. I was in special service, entertaining troops with gospel singing. And I got out of service 8 years before my time. I supposed to have been in the reserve for 8 years. After I got that, I got a permanent discharge from the service, and only thing I can say, I was in the army, but for it in the war, or nothing like that. I never did make it to the front line, or nothing like that. God seemed fit to bring me back home safely. I used my talent, what I had, over there singing, and that's all I can say. I can't say I've been dodging bullets or nothing like that. I just went in service and got in special service after they found out I could sing and got a quartet together over there. And I didn't have to do those other 8 years. The Lord fixed it some kind of way. I didn't question that. But I wore in the Army.
I was in the Air Force 12 years. Let me just quickly tell you something. George wrote this. I should have told you this over the years. Speaking of singing in the service, I was in the Air Force 12 years. I sung my way all the way through the Air Force. Let me tell you. I went in September of 49. After basic training, they sent me to Denver, to training school in Denver. This is in early 50. I was raised in the Baptist church, And I never did get too far away from the church while I was in the service. In other words, if there was a church around, eventually I found it and tried to get hooked up because I was lonesome and lonely and I knew about the church. Mm-hmm. And so I went to church in Denver and joined the church in Denver, got in the choir. And you talking about change your life. When I got in that choir in Denver, and I joined the choir, went to choir rehearsal on Tuesday, sung a song on Sunday. And my career in Denver for the rest of my time was sky high. But I put that Jefferson County gospel boom on and tore them up. And I became the king of Denver. And so I always stayed close to the church and close to God's saint. Then in June, as you remember, the war started in June 50, they sent me to Anchorage, Alaska. And after a while in Anchorage, there was no church. We were meeting, there were people meeting around house to house, having services and whatever thing. Eventually, enough of us got bold enough to start a church. Mm-hmm. In Anchorage, Alaska, when it was a territory, it's a state now, but it used to be a territory. Anchorage, Alaska, we started the first Black Baptist church in Anchorage, and I was the director of the choir, the solo singer, Sunday school teacher, and on the deacon board. Can I get a witness in that? The first Black gospel, Black Baptist, and now it has 10,000 members.
Wow.
And I was the original choir director of the first Black Baptist Church in Anchorage, Alaska. And we went on, we organized a singing group there called it Evangelists. And we got a radio spot on Sunday night at 10:30. I became the first Black man to sing gospel on the radio station in Anchorage, Alaska. Me and my group. And from that time on, I was king of Alaska. And so the story goes on and on. Every time I got to town, I found me a church and hit one. And that's all she wrote, amen? So I enjoyed singing in the service. That was my
thank
thing.
Thank you, that was a great story. That's really
interesting.
I just read your biography so you written up, and I kind of noticed that throughout the thing and read about your time in Alaska, so. It definitely works better to hear it in person. let's see, another topic today that we're talking about, we're going to cover some teaching and training, and then I also want to talk to the younger members about their interest in singing. But let's hear from some others here about the history of the training and teaching and how you learned to sing and how you're going about working with a new generation.
I would listen to my dad's group. I was around 5 or 6. Jimmy Ricks, for certain, nobody, Charlie Bridget, they would come out there and train my dad's group, the Macmillan Jubilee Singers. And that's how I started. And when I went to school, we went straight to the auditorium before we went to classes. Miss Green was our auditorium musician. She would teach us boys. And after she passed on, we had a lady named Miss Margaret Shaw. She taught us how to sing. That's my background. Later years, I was under a man called A. Edward Banks, some of y'all might remember him. He taught me how to sing too, in a different one. That's how I got started.
Let me say this about teaching and training. The singing I'm talking about here, it's not documented on a script. I mean, what I mean is, it's in here and here. It's not laid out. I'm sure it could be done. That guys who do that kind of thing can take it and make music out of it. But most, well, I would say all of the gospel training I got was from me listening and trial and error and finding myself able to sing where these guys are singing. There was never much sheet music involved in my gospel work. Never much training of, but it was in so ingrained in your mind. As a matter of fact, the Pillars, my friends, my group, they've been kind enough to let me move on like I'm trying to leave, me and Burton like we see. All this stuff I'm telling them straight out of here. I haven't put no sheet music in front of them, say, hey, man, now this is what you go up, down. But if he hear it and can sing it, I'll let you know whether or not you're singing it right or not. And if you hear it and can sing it, you got it. But all of our work, we learned it by just hearing it and singing it. It was never documented.
And people should know that if you sing in a choir or you sing in a chorus, it is very different from singing quartet. It is not the same thing. They don't translate over there. It's a different skill, a set of skills that has to be translated over. But I wanted to ask you one more question, Don, since we're talking about it. I want to certainly give Augusta a chance right afterwards to say whatever he wants to say. The Blue Goose, Leroy Garrett. Here's my question, Don, but then you can say anything you want about it because it's going to be fascinating. Leroy Garrett was the manager of the Heavenly Four. Right. We have pictures. Everything Don's saying is all captured in pictures that the Birmingham Black Radio Museum has. Did Leroy involve himself in training the singing part as well, or was he just manager?
No, he needs explaining. Please let me explain it. Leroy Garrett, a legend, Alabama legend. Leroy Garrett had a dry cleaners on 14th Street. Manhattan Cleaner was the name of it, on 14th Street and Avenue G on the south side, and on 6th Avenue south across from the city jail in Titusville. Well, the Heavenly Four was organized. We had a manager named Mr. Johnny. Mr. Johnny died. So Leroy's place was right there on 6th Avenue south across from the city jail. The dry cleaner was here down, the plant was down under there, and he had rooms down under there where you could sing. Anyway, we asked Leroy, could we rehearse in his cleaners down in the basement on Wednesday night? So he let us go down there and rehearse. Leroy fell in love with us. He liked the little boys singing and set out to decide to be our manager. Now, Leroy always had an eye for money. He thought, maybe I could put these fellas out there and make a few dollars. Anyway, whatever reason, he liked us. And he swooped us up and made us his group. There was never no election, no vote, no nothing. We knew that he was the manager. Because he had the place for rehearsal. And so Leroy then started promoting us, sending us, taking us wherever we need to go. Now let me tell you about Leroy and the Blue Goose and the radio station. So we were out singing. The Golden Bear had a microphone. They just threw this down the microphone. So Leroy said, y'all, we need, next Sunday, we got a program. Leroy, you see, can we borrow the microphone? So Leroy went over to ask Roosevelt to loan the microphone system so we could have the microphone. He wouldn't do it. All right. That went over there, WVOK had a color sign, which y'all didn't know about. It was on Sunday morning. Over there on 14th Street. Leroy Garrett, he let everybody sing. He was the engineer. Leroy could not read or write. I taught him how to write his name, putting my hand over here. That's the only thing he ever wrote. But he knew when to sign something. and he knew that was his name, because I taught him that. And so he became very proud, could not read or write, but he was a great engineer. He knew all that stuff. So much so until he decided he wanted a radio station of his own. So they wouldn't let him have one in Birmingham. He went to Huntsville. Sold his cleaners, moved out, went to Huntsville, bought a tract of land on Jordan Lane, is almost a half a big tract of land up there now, of course, Jordan Lane, and he set out to create his own radio station. They didn't want him in Huntsville either, but he held on, kept fighting the code, and finally got permission. He opened up WEUP, which is there now. Mm-hmm. Now it has five stations. Right. WEUP was founded by Leroy Garrett, our manager. And he was the first black owner station in Alabama. History says that. Mm-hmm. He became the first black man to own a radio station in Huntsville, Alabama. And we was his group. But at that time, many years ago, he founded the station, made it very, very popular. And so he had one program on his program, on his station, come on every Sunday morning. But he would come on every, he decided to come on and he, in other words, he signed on his radio station on every morning. He signed it on with a gospel radio program playing records. Leroy couldn't talk one sentence without messing up. So he would, all he was able to say was, good morning, it's the Blue Goose. That all. He became known as the Blue Goose. And famous worldwide, the Blue Goose, his Sunday morning radio program. If you were out there in gospel, Roscoe, you went to that station, you know where he was. I know you knew how Leroy was. Well, that was his thing. He became known as the Blue Goose on his own radio station. And he cranked it up every morning at 6 o'clock with his one radio program, 1 hour. The Blue Goose.
And Don,
if you've been there, Roscoe, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. We want to give Mr. Maul a chance. We also want to bring to everybody's attention the rest of the builders that are in the audience. I want to ask Aguster, if you would, to share the teaching and training and his roots.
Well, thank you. When I was very young, I did take some four-part harmony training from a Dr. McDonald. I lived in Selma, where we had a family group there, brother group. We sang there, and then later I sang with a group by the name of the Golden Gates, and we had a radio broadcast on WHBB and WGWC. One was on Wednesday night, and the other was on Sunday morning. And then a little later with the Friend of Four. Then I came here, and all the training that I received was very good, but that also, as Dr. Saul said, a lot of listening and learning from the old singers who was able to teach you things that you needed to know. And then when I joined in the Jubilees from Mr. Nard William, he continued with training, which was very helpful to me, and I'm grateful for that. And I must say, each day I live, I'm still learning. There's always something that you need to learn. And back to serving the Lord and trying to be the kind of person He would have us to be. When I went into service in the career conflict, there were so many guys going AWOL that it just disturbed you, that they're rather than go fight because it was a tough war. And I had been singing when I went into service. So there was a chaplain there, it was a full colonel. And I would go to church every Sunday morning. So he began to talk to me. I joined the choir and he promoted me to be the director of the choir. And talking to guys and encouraging them to go to church, many of the guys who was going AWOL stopped going. And the chaplain was able to help them with their problem. And then I was on docket to go to Korea, and all at once they said, Aguster Maul, take 3 steps back. And I got very scared. I said, wonder what I have done wrong. But it wasn't that. They wanted to give me an opportunity to work with the choir and at headquarter, 44th Infantry Division and 2nd Division. The general of that section was the one who had me to come back. And I served there with him and there in the choir where we had a good fellowship. And I find through the years, if you will stay with the Lord, and if you will do what's right, and just love everybody, if you can't help a person, make sure you don't hurt them. And the Lord will bless you, and you will have friends who will also give you a helping hand. And being an old man now, I tell my children daily, try to do something good for somebody. And if you can't help them, make sure you don't hurt them. And I know myself, if you just pray and do right, God will bless you. He will give you the love that you need to be a trust. But I never did want to leave. And then last but not least, the Nightingales, when Julia's Cheeks was there, I also had opportunity to go and sing with them. So I had a chance to go, but in the early days, there wasn't much broadcasting going. The one station that Reverend Saul just spoke about was in Bessemer down there by the Bessemer Gym Hospital. And we were singing there. There wasn't many groups there at that time singing, but this was right behind Mr. Blevin's days. We would go down and broadcast. And on through the years, for some 57 years, I have been associated with radio broadcasting. And recently we came off, but it's been a blessing to us. And I love trying to sing and praise the Lord. He has been good to me. I appreciate him. And last, on this note, I appreciate all these brethren that I know so well, my friends, that we have sang together, love one another, and works together with one another. On the 27th of November of this year, the Dells Allen celebrate our 63rd anniversary at the Bessemer Civic Center, 4 o'clock in the evening. And if any of you all can come, we'll be honored to have you. Thank you,
thank you. Thank you. Okay, we're gonna do sound check from 5 to 5:30, so there's our long break. We're still gonna get it in there, I hope. But I want the younger members here to tell us a little bit about how they were drawn to the gospel quartet tradition and how they are
born in church. I say it because my people had church in the house that I was born, brought back to from the hospital. Reverend Solomon here, this is my pastor. And I guess he recognized that I could sing some. I started when I was about 6 years old, and I've been singing ever since. I've been always singing quartet for the last probably about 14 months.
I appreciate them taking the time to break it down for me, because most of the time I've been singing jazz, and I've been singing the blues, and I've been a soloist. So as far as coming into the quartet environment, it has really been a blessing, and it's really been hard for me at times. But like I said, I have great teachers, and I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Larry Ford, and myself, I've been around gospel music all of my life. I had an uncle, Willie Ford, that sang with the Gospel Spirituals, and we had a group as children. I started singing when I was about 6 years old. But the name of our group was the Youth Voices of Hope. And we followed my uncle and his group, the Gospel Spirituals, around. That's how I met these guys. I didn't get to know them until lately. But I'm a fourth generation minister. Reverend Solomon is my pastor. And he brought me into the group as a fifth to support Mr. Burton. And now he has decided he was going to break me in on baritone. Now that's a task. The world's greatest baritone sits right there next to Reverend Solomon. He had a voice operation. But Mr. M.B. Wooden is the greatest baritone, according to Mr. Don Solomon. But here again, I'm glad to be here, and I hope to be in gospel music for the rest of my life.
Amen.
You
Now we're going to have to save some final questions for the next time we get together, but because we need to do sound check, and everybody else go outside, enjoy visiting. If you have any questions for our author or for the filmmaker, Robert Plym, feel free to do so and come back in here.